Morning, folks. It seems that it didn't happen the way I wanted, so we're just going to do it this way. I want you guys to hear this. This is a cool song I came across today. I think I'm going to be adding it. Amazing grace. I'm looking for somebody who is mighty to save. I found resurrection power wrapped in a song. Amen. 10,000 reasons you should sing along to that child. Amen. Jesus music. It's a Friday, folks. We got to celebrate. We got to lift our hands. We got to get our hearts rocking and rolling. What say you? You guys with me? Hey, Dot. Dot, tell me if you can hear that music. Morning, Naomi. I'm going to have to figure out how to take those off of a video and just get just the soundtrack because it won't let me load the video, so I've got to play it off to the side like this. But that's a job for later today or tomorrow or next week, whenever. Hey, folks, how you doing this morning? Oh, Patriots, family, and friends, music is good. You bet. You know what? Seeing as how there's only three of us here, Dot, would you mind listening to that song again? Because I love that song. It's like the old country music, kind of gospel. Where'd it go? There it went. There it is. I was listening to this morning, and it just. Do you need a God of wonder? Amazing grace. I got slammed today, this morning. It just, Jesus butted his way right in and just came right in and took over, man. Wrapped in a song, oh yeah, and 10,000 reasons you should sing along. That Jesus music. Oh, nuts. Okay, I'm going to try and do something. I forgot to do something. If you guys get cut off, give me about 3 minutes and I will get back in here again, okay? Okay, it looks like you're still up. I don't know if the music is still playing or not. Good, that one. And yes, okay. So I got to move you. Oh, I can't move you. Okay. We'll just start down here then. Come on. There we go. Okay. I completely forgot to do this. Oh, horse feathers and hockey sticks. It's not allowed because it's got the picture up there in the corner and I can't move it. Oh, I'll just paste it. It was plain text. There we go. I apologize, guys. I hope you can still hear me. Yes, I'm here. I'm just trying to get this put together the way it should be. Go on, give me the option. Give it to me. Okay, maybe if I just go right on the picture. Okay, I'm not going to be able to do this. Oh, you guys are out, unfortunately, but Getter, nobody watches on Getter anyways. Send it over to Telegram. Hopefully I can do it on Telegram. Yeah, I can, right there. Beautiful. Why can't these other people be like this? And send it. There we go. All right. Okay, are you back? Don't mind our technical difficulties. Good morning, Rebecca. Good morning, Chu. Hey, Tammy, how you doing? Tell me, am I still here? Am I still hot, or do I need to re-crank this thing? Somebody give me a thumbs up, a yes, a go, no go. Anything? Good. Okay. Thank you, Naomi. You know what? We're 9 minutes in. It doesn't matter. It's a Friday. We're going to play this again because there's a lot more people here. That's a good start, right? Okay, we'll just do like that. You know what? We'll just leave it for now. We're having some problems with some of the music, folks. But, Naomi and I are working on bringing in some more music. I got a lot of different songs that we got to modify so that they'll work. But it's good to have you guys here this morning. It's a Friday, folks. We made it through the week. Always remember, it's day 40. Day 41 is coming. Okay. I watched Jeremy this morning and it was a heart-wrenching show this morning because just the subject matter and everything. But did you get my email last night? Stand by. Give me 1 second. Yep, there you are. Okay, good. Oh, man, it's up there in the corner where I can't get. That's stupid. Okay. Rebecca, I'm going to have to check. I apologize. I didn't check it last night. I went to bed real early last night because I was wiped, and I did not check. I will check it as soon as I get off of here, and I will answer you back. I have to go. We had a blessing yesterday. We're getting another freezer for the house. It's something we've been praying about because I don't know about you guys, but I love my meat. And I understand that people have different dietary needs and such. And around here, it's my blood type is O positive, which means I need that protein. And I was just thumbing through the internet last night while I was finishing up on my Bible study. And I saw this freezer. And I looked at where it was, and it's located literally 2 blocks from my house. And the people are selling it. And my wife looked it up, and she said, yeah, what they're asking for it is an excellent price. And I said, okay. I said, at half the price, are we able, hey, Alligator, in the USA. I said, are we able to find that? Can we afford to take that money out of the budget? And she says, well, she says, I've kind of been saving up for a new freezer. So, yeah, we've got the money. So we're going to go over and pick that up today. And I'm going to have to rearrange the shop so I can put another large freezer in here. But it's a blessing. It's going to be, it's not going to be just for us. It's going to be what I like to do around Thanksgiving or just after Thanksgiving. I probably won't be doing a lot of it now that I know what they do to our meat, but I used to go down and buy when they had the chickens, the turkeys, when they go on sale, I'd buy 5 or 6 turkeys and throw them in the freezer. And then I have those to give out to people through the year when people needed something to eat or, you know, they needed, food or whatever. And I said, well, I got a turkey, you know, and I'd turn that over. So, So I got stuff I got to get done, but Rebecca, I will get back to you today. I'm not sure where you are in the country. I'm on the Pacific coast and I'll get to you before, and you have my word on this, I will get to you before noon today, my time. Now, if you're on the East Coast, that would be, what, like 3 p.m. your time. So hopefully there's not a time constraint on your email, but I'll find out. I will get on it right away, okay? So, anyways, folks, it's just been wild and crazy. I've had stuff going on in Tennessee. So you're, right now it's, what, 9:15 where you are? or are you on East Coast time, or you, is it 10:15? Either way, I will get to it. Hopefully, if it's 10:15, there's a chance I may not make it by noon for your time, but I will do my darndest to get it there. Okay, I will read that and get back to you. I got one of my birthday presents in the mail yesterday. I can already tell you, I'm not going to tell you what it is because I want to try it out a little bit more. But if this morning is any indication, it's some good stuff. 9:15. So you're 2 hours ahead. Okay. So I will get to you. I will get to you by noon today. You have my word on that. It's been very interesting. And then today's Bible study, we're talking about the power of relentless prayer. Relentless prayer. Remember in the Bible that it says that we are to pray consistently. We're supposed to pray constantly. Okay. Man, that kind of a question statement is one of the things that will get you banned out of here so fast that you're going to be gone and you're going to wonder what just happened. So if you'd like to be here, you're more than welcome. We welcome you to be here. But you will have respect for me and you will respect my family here. And if you continue like that, I got a squirrel that'll help you out the door. So if you understand my meaning, then you're more than happy to put your feet up and sit back and get you some Jesus, because it sounds like you need some. So, relentless prayer, praying consistently, constantly. Okay. We have someone who thought it might be funny to make a remark, so I was just helping him understand the error of his ways is all, alligator. And it's something like we talked about yesterday. I was mentioning, it doesn't matter if you're standing up, you know, it says pray when you're standing, pray when you're sitting, pray when you're laying down, you know, pray when you're in the shower, pray when you're working, pray when you're out in the yard pulling weeds, pray when you're out working on the car. Okay. Cause it's not like you have to go to a place to be able to pray. You don't have to be in a certain mindset or a certain place or anything. Okay. And you don't want to wait until it's an emergency and you're running to God asking him, you know, oh, save this or do that or whatever it is. You already want to have that line of communication open. Okay. Thank you, Naomi. And you want to be able to already have that communication where you're comfortable talking to God. Okay, so let's get started with our verse of the day, or verse of the week, actually, our memory verse. We are in Ephesians 6, 18 and 19. And this is, the heading on this is pray for boldness. Okay, this is coming out of Ephesians. And I looked at my video the other night, and it looked like I'm like trying to sit right up in your lap or something. I'm so close. So I apologize for that. I didn't realize how the camera really looked when you guys were watching it. Okay. So it says, pray for boldness, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make it known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. We need to pray, but we need to also, through that, we get the understanding the will of God, and we are able to speak wisely, boldly about who Jesus is in our life. If you've been here for any time, you know that my life has not been all, you know, roses and daffodils. It's I've had to fight through a whole lot of stuff. I've had to take care of a lot of stuff in my life to get straight. And not drugs or anything like that. It's just a lot of other stuff. And a lot of the stuff that I had to overcome was overcome by God. Because I couldn't do it. There's no way I could do it. If I was still trying to do it myself, who knows where I'd be right now. But through friends, through family, through mentors, I've slowly been able to right the ship and get going where God wants me to go, realizing that the only way out of this dust bowl is with Jesus. Okay? He is the only way into heaven. He is the only way that I can even get anywhere. So in that, let's go before God. Let's take it to God and get this started the way it should be. Father God, I just come before you humbly, Father God, and I just ask you, Lord, that you would bless this time, that your spirit would fill this space, Father God. I ask you, Father God, not only for myself, but for all of those here, Father God, if there is any sin in us, please bring it to the surface. Let it be known to us, Father God. Whether it's small or insignificant, what we think is no big deal, any sin against you, Father God, is a death sentence. Because you have said, you have told us that the wages of sin is death. And Father, I don't want that. I want for me and my family here and anybody that I meet, Father, I want them to know you. I want them, Father God, to understand what you've done for them. How you sent your son. He shed his blood on the cross for us, Father God. And every time that we sin, he does it again, and he does it again, and over, because he carries that load. And every time we sin, it just puts another sin on him, because he's taken it from us, if we have accepted him as our Lord and Savior. Father, I just ask you to fill this space, fill my shop, fill the homes of all these people here, whether they're in their cars, whether they're in the bathroom, they're in the shower, they're in the tub, they're changing the baby, they're mopping a floor, they're at work in a cubicle. It doesn't matter where they are, Father God, fill that space with your spirit. Any chaos, any distraction, Father God, from your word, let it subside. Let it just fade away, Father God, that their attention can be on you and on your word. Father God, I just ask you to bless this word, bless this family. For those who need healing, Father God, for those who need direction, for those who need an answer. Sometimes no answer is an answer. It just means wait. And we have to learn our patience. I had to learn that the hard way. You had to put me on a timeout for 4 years. And I understand that. But I came out of it for a better person. And I thank you for that. I give you the glory and the honor, Father God. There's nothing that I can do without you. And there's nothing that I'd ever want to do without you. So, Father, I ask you, I beg you, be here, be with us. Send your spirit, Father God, that we would understand the words that you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. No, because if you keep sinning, Fandy, if you keep sinning over and over and over again, the repentance isn't there. If I worked for you, you're my boss. Right? You write my paycheck. And if I work for you and I come to you and you say, Dana, I need you to do such and so. I say, okay, I'll get it done. And then I don't do it. And then you come and you hunt me down on the shop floor and you say, hey, I told you that I needed this done. You didn't do it. Now I'm behind schedule. I'm going to have to give it to somebody else. And then it happens again. And you say, Dana, I need you to do this and I don't do this. How long how long are you going to allow me to work for you and yet deny your will of what needs to be done? Now, you're looking out for the good of the company. You're looking out for the good of the other employees. Keep that in mind. There's other people involved. You're looking for that. How long will you keep me working for you? You won't. There'll come a time when you're going to call me into the office. You're going to hand me my pink slip. And you're going to say, you know, this isn't a good fit. I've been asking you to do things and you're not doing them. So I'm going to have to let you go. Maybe you can find employment somewhere else that better suits you. Well, Jesus isn't going to do that. But if we keep sinning over and over and over again, then I highly suggest that you do a very deep dive on, did you actually give your life to Christ? Because just like my service dog, he lives to serve me. He is always at my side. He's in the house right now because I don't have room in the shop for him. Okay? He's a 96-pound shepherd. That dog takes up more room than he has a right to. But he knows what he's supposed to do. He is always there. Okay? If we keep sinning against Jesus, it's like my service dog, every time I want him to do something or I need him to do something for me, he says, yeah, I'll get to it whenever I get to it. And he comes back and says, hey, man, I'm sorry. I didn't get that done. I apologize. Right? Oh, it's very easy, Fandy. It's very easy. Because what other people do, what their choices are, is the life that they have to lead. Okay? But you want to understand something. It takes two to go to war. If you look at Jesus, he didn't have a war. Why? He had legions. He had legions of angels that in less than a split second, he can call down. He could have devastated the whole Roman Empire, one of the greatest, greatest entities in the world, right? He didn't. Because he understood that man had sin in his heart. Okay? So, it takes two to tango. If you want to start a fight, you need somebody else who's going to retaliate. What happens if one side in a war lays down all their guns and says, we're not going to kill any of you. We're done. We're finished. You no longer have a war. That's like a bully who keeps beating up on the kid on the school grounds, day after day after day after day. Okay? Eventually, the other kids are going to be going, you know what? Why don't you just leave him alone? You think you're all Billy Bad Stuff and everything, and why don't you pick on somebody your own size? Why don't you go toe for toe? It's been my belief ever since I was a very young man that war is not the right way. You want to have a war? Great. You send out your number one. We send out our number one. You send out the leader of your nation. We send out the leader of our nation. That's the way it should be. Why send out 18 and 20-year-olds? Why send out, you know, whatever? You're just wasting their lives. Your whole nation suffers because you have a generation that's lost. Our country has generations now that are lost because of war. Hundreds and millions of men and women die. Why? Because somebody sitting in an office somewhere said, hey, I want a piece of that country. Go invade that country and take over that piece of land. I want that piece of land for my country. Greed. So there we get to it. That's the reason for war, is greed. There is no other reason. I don't care if you're in Israel. I don't care if you're in the Gaza Strip. I don't care if you're in Ukraine. I don't care if you're in Russia. I don't care if you're in China. I don't care if you're in Thailand. I don't care where you are. If you send your army against another nation, you start it, It's because of greed. And you can't tell me any otherwise. So when you stop the greed, when you start looking at your brothers and your sisters and saying, you know what? You may be a darker color skin than I am, or you may speak a different language than I am, but we're still brothers and sisters. That's when peace will come. When you keep pointing fingers at people, when people keep pointing fingers at you, it's not going to get any better. So, I'll apologize right now because you're talking to a warrior. That's what I did. Okay? Was it something I wanted to do? No. Would I have rather been home doing my woodworking and everything? Yes. Was I told that I needed to go? Yes. So I went. Was it because I wanted their property? No. But do I agree with them? No. That was the reason I got out. I got out a long, long time ago. But I still don't agree with it. There is reasons for war sometimes when people start to rattle their swords. They start to say that the boundary is not where it is. That's a problem they had back in ancient times. People would go out and move their markers. They would move the boundary markers. And then they'd have a fight. You want to know where that really comes from? I'll tell you a story. This guy owns a donkey and he ties it up to a tree. Now, Satan comes by one day and unties the donkey. Just to kind of stir the pot. Donkey goes into his next door neighbor, into the next farmer's field, and starts eating and stomping on his corn and such and tearing up his fields. Farmer in that field had enough of it. Walks over and he shoots the donkey. Goes back in his house. The first farmer comes out looking for his donkey. He's not tied to the tree. Where the heck did he go? And he looks over and he sees him going through the field and he's like, oh, great. Now I'm going to have to go over and talk to him and I'm going to have to make this right. And he starts to follow the path and he finds his donkey laying there dead on the ground. And he sees that there's a path through the fields back to the house. And he says, well, he must have done it. So he goes back to the house, he gets his gun, he goes over, he kills his neighbor. Neighbor's wife gets all bent out of shape. She sends her two boys over. Okay? And they go over and they shoot the other farmer. And this goes on for a while. And finally, one of them, as things are kind of winding down because ain't nobody else left to shoot, they shoot the family, they shoot the kids, they shoot the wife, they shoot everybody. And finally, one of them, the time comes and judgment day, and he goes to God. He says, why did you let all this happen? Why did you do all of this? You knew this was going on. God said, you need to talk to Satan about it. And he goes down, he says, what do you got to do with this? And he says, I ain't got nothing to do with your little thing going on. He says, well, I was told you were the one to talk to. You're the one that caused the problem. And he says, no. All I did was untie a donkey. He says, all the rest of it was on you jackasses. All of it was on man, because man didn't stop. It could have stopped if the first guy had, when he tied it up, he made sure that it wasn't going anywhere. It could have stopped if the second guy had taken it back to the tree and tied it up really good, and then went and told the first farmer, hey, your mule got loose, or your donkey got loose, and I tied him back up to the tree. Now there would have been peace. Okay? If he didn't do that, then maybe the first farmer goes to the second one and says, look, man, my donkey will eat up all your food in your field, and I'll make it right. I've got a bumper crop this year. I will make sure that I replace everything that he ate. Okay? See, man has a choice. And this is what pisses me off more than anything else. Everybody says, well, it's them, well, it's them, well, it's them. No, it's you. It's me. Because I have a choice. I'm a peaceful man. I love people. But you break the law, and you need to be punished for what you do. And that's on both sides. Okay, Fundy? It's on both sides. It's on your side, and it's on the other side. It's on Russia's shoulders, and it's on Ukraine's shoulders. Now, if their leaders were real men, I don't mean talking mouths. I don't mean dress up in my pretend wannabe army suit, you know, like they do in Ukraine, or Putin, who acts all bad and like he's all, you know, he's all tough and everything. Who cares if he was in their special forces or anything? I don't care. I've lived with those people. I don't care. He'll die just like everybody else, just like you, just like me. What we've got to do is we've got to make our heart right with God. Okay? Exactly. America's no different than any other country in the world. Every single country, every single person will suffer the consequences of their choices. It's how I brought my children up. It's how my grandchildren are being taught. The choices that you make will dictate the life that you lead. So, Fundy, I implore you to search your choices. Don't hate because your father's hated. Don't hate because your neighbor's hated. Don't hate for any of that. Because all that does is it blackens your heart. It makes you angry. You look to who's causing the problem. And I don't mean point a finger at another country. No. Just like any other army in the world, their soldiers go where they're told to go. They do what they're told to do, what they're trained to do. If I had two attack dogs, and you come on my property, and one of my dogs rips your arm off, that's your problem. You stepped onto my property. You came in where you don't belong. Okay? I've had security dogs. I had one that would sit literally right at the edge, the boundary of my property. And people could walk by and he just didn't care. He'd lay down, he'd look at him like, hey, how you doing? Good to see you, man. Have a good day. And one day we were out there and the kid playing next door and their ball came across the yard. Now, he knew children. He knew children were not bad. Okay? So he watched them. And he watched them serious. Now, if that had been a grown man come across that property, maybe we may have a problem. Okay? But he knew. You know. I know. It's not right. So, let's get into this. The power of relentless prayer. We already talked about Ephesians 6, 18 and 19. So the first verse is Genesis 18, 16 to 33. Genesis 18, 16 to 33. It's kind of a long run here. This is Abraham's faith is tested. Then the men rose from there and looked toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to send them on their way. Okay, now, a run up to this. Abraham is there near Sodom and Gomorrah, the angels come walking through, right? And, you know, the angels are there. And so they stop for the night. You know the story, you know. The town, the whole town comes and bangs on his door and says, hey, give us the two men that are in there. And Lot's like, nah, you don't want to do this, man. You really don't want to do this. Okay, so it goes on. In 13 it says, the Lord said to Abram, why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I surely bear a child since I am old? God says, is anything hard for the Lord? And it goes on into 15, but Sarah denied it, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. And he said, no, but you did laugh. So we get into 16. Then the men rose from there and looked toward Sodom, and Abram went with them to send them on their way. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm doing? Since Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I've known him, in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him, what God has spoken to him. And the Lord said, because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now. Now understand, God says, I will go down. God walked on this earth. I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry against it, and against it that has come to me. And if not, I will know. In other words, he'll know if somebody's lying to him. Then the men turned away from there and went towards Sodom. But Abraham still stood before the Lord. And Abraham came near and said, would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there were 50 righteous within the city. Would you also destroy that place and not spare it for the 50 righteous that were in it? See, he's trying to figure out, he's trying to find out what's God's plan. He's asking him, look, man, even if there's 50 people, are you going to destroy those 50 righteous people just because the town is bad? Okay? We all know that different societies have a small integral group that is very bad. Okay? But their country is judged by what that small group does. Okay? Suppose there were, 50 righteous. It goes on. God says, far be it. This is so Abraham. He says, far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. Far be it from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? He's calling God out. He's saying, hey, look, man, God, you're going to do this, but this isn't who you are. He's trying to be that needle on the compass. He's trying to say, look, Lord, this isn't you. This is not, okay? This isn't right. And the Lord said, if I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I will spare all the place for their sakes. So now we've got the bargain. There's your counteroffer. He says, all right, fine. If I find 50 people that are righteous, I'll cut the whole place slack. I'll let them go. Then Abraham answered and said, indeed now, I who am but dust and ashes have taken it upon myself to speak to the Lord. So he's kind of making sure that God knows that he understands his place. He's nothing but dust. So Abraham goes on, suppose there were 5 less than the 50 righteous. Would you destroy all of the city for the lack of 5? And God said, if I find there 45, I will not destroy it. Then he spoke to him yet again and said, suppose there should be 40 found there. And God said, I will not do it for the sake of 40. And Abraham said, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak. Suppose 30 should be found there. And God said, I will not do it if I find 30 there. Then he said, indeed now, I have taken it upon myself to speak to the Lord. Suppose 20 should be found there. And God said, I will not destroy it for the sake of 20. And Abraham said, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak but once more. Suppose 10 should be found there. And God said, I will not destroy it for the sake of 10. Okay, it goes into 33. So the Lord went his way as soon as he had finished speaking with Abraham, and Abraham returned to his place. And that's where it goes on after that in chapter 19 about the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. The heading on this is talking about following examples who wouldn't be denied in prayer. It says to tell their story. I said, basically, Abraham spoke to God and talked him down from 50 righteous to 10, at which time God went his way, as did Abraham. Okay, well, he still destroyed the place, didn't he? His angels went into the city. Yeah, it's a weird setting in the camera, Chef. I don't know what it is. It's like looking, it keeps coming up telling me that it can't find a face. So I guess maybe I need to shave. Maybe it'll find my face then. I don't know. Anyways, after that is when they go into the city all that happens, right? So the next one we go into is Genesis 32:24-30. Oh no. I just lost my place. Hang on a second. Genesis, there we go, 32:24-30. Oh, one more page. There we go. Okay. So 32:24-30. And that reads, then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now, when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched, now this is meaning this man did not prevail against Jacob, okay? And when he did not prevail against him, he, the man, whoever this person is, we don't know yet, touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he, meaning the person, said, let me go, for the day breaks. But Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. So the stranger said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And the person said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. 30, okay. Then Jacob asked him, saying, tell me your name, I pray. And the stranger said, why is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. He fought with God. Jacob fought with God, or with his angel. I believe, I don't know which I believe. Some people say it was an angel. Some people say it was God himself. And Jacob wrestled with him. And the stranger, the angel, God, whichever, couldn't prevail over Jacob. Okay. No, I don't, Mary. And so he couldn't prevail over him. So what did he have to do? He reached and he set his hip off. If any of you've ever had a joint get out of place, it hurts. And it's a whole lot, it saves me a whole lot of money on shampoo and haircuts and stuff, Mary. When I came out of the military, I had a high and tight. And then they still wanted to charge me $16. And this was back in the early 90s. They wanted to charge me $16 to give me a haircut. So I figured I'll just do it myself. And been doing it ever since. Yeah, I've had my right shoulder dislocated. I've had my left shoulder dislocated. I've had my knee, my right knee, and my right hip. And yeah, you're absolutely right, Tippy, or Tip, Trip. Sorry, Trip. It hurts. It hurts like nothing you've ever felt before. Okay. If you guys have ever watched, I don't know if any of you watch movies or not or whatever, but I can't remember the name of the movie now. Anyways, there's one of them in there that his shoulder pops in and out all the time. Hi, Lisa. Welcome. So even after he did that to Jacob, he continued to wrestle with Jacob. Jacob didn't give up. He grabbed him and he held on and he said, well, you need to let go of me, man. Daylight's coming. I got to get gone. And Jacob said, no, I ain't letting go of you. You need to bless me first. I ain't letting go of you. And he said, all right, what's your name? And he says, Jacob. And he says, no longer will you be called Jacob. You will now be called Israel. But that came from relentless prayer. Okay. The next one, Genesis. That was that one. Okay. Yeah, so we're on to, I beg your pardon, we're on to Deuteronomy 9, 18 and 19. Deuteronomy 9, 18 and 19. The heading on this says, Moses rehearses Israel's rebellion. Okay. So, 18 and 19, right? Yes. It says, and I fell down before the Lord as at the first, 40 days and 40 nights. I neither ate bread nor drank water because of all your sin which you committed in doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. Now, he is talking to Israel, okay? Command of the former to meet me, either in the destroy and block persuasion. So Moses is talking to Israel. Moses is telling them what they've done, right? At this point, they've already gone from chapter 9, verse 1, up to chapter 9, verse 18, verse 17. He's talking about everything they've done, how they've been out of line, everything that they've screwed up, right? And he says in 18, and I fell down before the Lord as at the first 40 days and 40 nights. Well, it's interesting because we discussed 40, day 41. Okay. If you look through the Bible, the 40th day was always a turning point. Okay. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights. Then what happened? The sun came out. Okay. The Israelites and the Philistines fought for 40 days before David went out there and took out Goliath. That was on the 41st day that he did that. All through the Bible, you'll notice that it's 40 days are trials. 40 years, the Israelites wandered through the desert for 40 years. Then, in the 41st year, they were given the land of milk and honey. Okay, I was always told, a lot of the reading that I had done was that was done because that was about the lifespan. So they wanted, God wanted that whole generation, the rebellious generation that had turned their back on God to be, if you will, erased. And they would raise the new generation, the next generation. So, as he goes on, he says, you provoked him to anger. Moses says, for I was afraid of the anger and hot displeasure with which the Lord was angry with you to destroy you. But the Lord listened to me at that time also. Moses was in fervent prayer for Israel. He didn't want them to die, okay? He didn't want them to be wiped out. And he was in fervent prayer to God. And because God listened. They were saved. So, that was what came from relentless prayer, praying unceasingly. Okay, now that doesn't mean you keep repeating, like some, you repeat the same mantra, if you will, the same prayer over and over and over and over again. Exactly, Tammy. And that's something else. I mean, that's something else we need to pray for. We need to pray for this group. We need to pray for the people that are here, that are coming in, for those who do and those who do not know who God is. Okay? So, Moses prayed and God heard his prayer. Next one, Matthew 15:22-28. All right, I got to dig this one out because I still have stuff from the last one. 6578675309. No. All right, where is I'm supposed to be in Matthew. So 9 and 10 are not part of it. Okay, back here. So all of you can leave. Oh, that's why. Yeah, that's where I'm supposed to be. Okay. So, Matthew 15:22-28. So the heading on this is Jesus heals the Gentile woman. Right? Matthew 15:22-28. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from the region and cried out to him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed." But he, Jesus, answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she cries out after us." But Jesus answered and said, quote, "I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Okay, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then she came and worshipped him, saying, "Lord, help me." But he answered her and said, "It is not good that," pardon me, this is Jesus speaking again, quote, "It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs." In other words, she was from Canaan. She was a Canaanite. She was not a Jew. She was not a Israelite. She was not a Jew. And he says, "I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." So his op that he's supposed to be on is for the house of Israel. That's who he's supposed to be looking out for, taking care of, right? Let pass through the chat and do listen and come back. Exactly. That's what we can pray for, Naomi. Absolutely. You are absolutely right. So she, you know, he says, "Hey, look, I'm supposed to be looking after Israel." She's a Canaanite. And she said, "True, Lord. Yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered and said to her, "O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. Her faith, her belief was so strong that even though Jesus knew, I'm here for the Israelites. I'm here for Israel. But he also knew that there would be some that believed who were outside of that realm. He knew that that would happen, okay? And that they would come and they would seek him out. That's what we're supposed to do. We are to go, we are to seek him out, to find him, to hear his word, the word he has for us. And you're right, Tripp. It was her faith. Because he says, O woman, great is your faith. And there's an exclamation point. He is making a major statement. He's got all his disciples around him. And he's probably got his Israelites. He's probably got some of the Levites. You know, they're the priests of the Israel tribe. Sorry, I didn't shut that off this morning. And they know he's there for them. And she's like, Lord, right? And he realizes that her faith far surpasses where she's from or anything, okay? And he says, let it be to you as you desire. What was her desire? She only went to him for one reason. She didn't care about herself. For a Canaanite to go into Israel, to go through these people to get to him was unheard of. Why? Why did she do it? She did it because of her love for her daughter. She says in the beginning, she says, Lord, help me. But he answered, okay. And she's, no, back up, Dana. Come on. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried out to him. Now, she didn't come from the next town. She didn't come from the city that was just maybe, you know, a couple miles over. She came from another region. That means that she's been tracking him. She's been hunting him. She's been trying to find him. She's probably been going out of her way, going into other cities of places where she's not accepted. Okay? I mean, and I'm going to be brutal about this, and I'm going to say this. Some of you ain't going to like it, and I, you know what? I'm not even going to say I'm sorry. But as you can see, I'm white. There are places here in California, and there's places on the East Coast where let's just say that the love is not strong for white people. That would be like me walking into those towns, into those areas, and saying, I'm looking for Jesus. I heard he was here. Where did he go? Where can you tell me where he went? That is the kind of, and for a woman to do this in that time is unheard of, okay? Because you don't do that. For those that are of the Middle East descent, you know, or you know of that, you can verify that. In that time, the women, that was not what they did. You don't go out there and start walking around trying to find somebody, okay? And yet she kept doing it. Why? Because she knew her daughter needed that healing. It would be like me if one of my family members was dying or sick. I would go to the ends of the earth. I would sell everything in my shop. I would sell everything I own, everything I have, to be able to find the person. I hear rumors. Oh, this person is in this country and they have a healing for that. Or they're in this country and they have a... I would go to the ends of the earth and back again to heal my family member. Okay? This woman puts her life on the line for her daughter. And she goes to him and she calls him Lord, which means she knows who he is. She knows his stature, if you will. Understand, everybody, you know, they say, oh, his name is Jesus Christ. No, his name was Jesus. Christ is a position in heaven. Christ is what he was. Like if you go to a church where they have pastors, you call, oh, hi, Pastor Steve. Okay. It's the same thing. That's his level. That's his where he is. That's who he was. So she overcame the fear of going into a country where she probably, you know, any other time would probably not make it out alive. Okay. She's a woman by herself, most likely. She's not a woman of means. And she finally catches up with him. And the disciples say, send her away, man. She's making a ruckus. She's drawing a lot of attention. We don't need this. This is bad. This is bad news. This is bad press, man. We don't want this kind of press. And yet he says, well, hang on a minute. And he says, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So in other words, if you're not part of the Israel, the house of Israel, I'm not really meant to be doing whatever you need me to do. Right? And again, she implores him, please, Lord, Lord, my daughter is dying from demons. You need to heal her, please. You're the only one that can do it. Okay? You got to imagine, she's probably on her knees. She's probably crying because her daughter is dying. Right? But he answered and said, is it not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs? Now he calls her a dog. Take the children, who? The children, Israel, the children of God, to take their food, in other words, him, his healing ability, and throw it to a Canaanite? Throw it to a dog, as far as they were concerned? A lower class person? And she said, true, Lord, yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. When people ask me how I'm doing, I tell them I'm living at the edge of God's table. Sorry, I had to kill a black widow. I'm living at the edge of God's table. Why? Am I forgiven? Yes. Have I earned a seat at the table? No. No, that's for guys like Moses, Jacob. That's for the ones who are truly blessed by God. Me? I'm just forgiven. I'm not blessed. I'm just forgiven. Okay? You might say I am blessed. However you want to look at it. But when I read this years and years ago, that is the way that I felt. I'm living at the edge of God's table. I'm still getting the blessings. I still get the blessing. Any blessing that flows off the table, I get. Okay? You guys get the very same thing. But, do I feel worthy? No, I don't. Because I've done things in my life that you don't want to know about in places that you'll never hear about. Okay, for reasons that makes no sense to anybody. And that's something I've got to carry with me all the days of my life. Other people have sinned. They've killed people, or they're in prison, or whatever they've done. Okay? And when I run across somebody who's in prison because they didn't do anything, okay? A perfect example right now, In our federal prison, is an inmate named Peter Navarro. And no matter, I don't care what you think, I don't care what you think about politics, I don't care what you think about any of that. Okay? An illegitimate, if you will, in his sight, court, kangaroo court, demanded that he show up to talk to them. No, you want to talk to me? You get your rosy red backside into an airplane and you fly out here and you come out here and you stand in my shop and talk to me. We're going to talk on my grounds. I'm not coming to yours. No. Why? Because that's like me walking into the lion's den. I'm on their turf. No. We meet on even ground. We meet somewhere where it's even between us. Okay? Exactly. It is, Cleo. Reverend King, that dude had so much love in his heart. It was crazy. With everything that he went through, I mean, it was insane. And he kept doing it because he believed, he loved Jesus. He loved God. He loved the people. Okay? And that's a perfect example of being colorblind. Because I don't think it mattered to him what color you were. Are you white, red, black, yellow, orange, green with purple polka dots? It wouldn't matter. It didn't matter what you ate. It didn't matter what you did. Okay? He loved the people. He didn't love this portable mobile meat sack that we have on the outside. He loved their hearts. He loved who they were or who they are. Loved them for who they are. So that was Matthew 15, 20 through 28. Next one is Acts 12, 3 through 17. No, I'm looking for 5. Did I pull? I didn't pull 5. Where is 5? Oh, 5 is back here. Okay. Acts, hard word to say. 12, 3 through 17. This is going to be another long one. And it says, Peter is miraculously released from prison. Okay. Interesting, we talk about Peter being in prison and such, right? Interesting. And it is Peter. Peter Navarro. This is Peter. Peter's miraculously released from prison. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread. So when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison, and he delivered him to 4 squads of soldiers to keep him. One man for 4 squads of soldiers? Okay, that's crazy. To keep him, intending to bring him before the people after Passover. So Passover, the going into Passover is the unleavened bread, okay? And after that ceremony was, after that time was over, then he was going to take Peter before the Jews, okay? So verse 5, Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Now, who's praying? The church. It's not just him. You bet he's praying, but it's the church that's praying for him. And when Herod was about to bring him out that night, Peter was sleeping, bound with 2 chains between 2 soldiers. And the guards before the door were keeping the prison. In other words, he's got all these guards. Now, they're probably on a watch rotation. Okay? So, maybe every 4 hours, maybe every 8 hours, they would switch out the guards so that the other ones could get sleep. If you've ever been in the military, you know what it's like standing a watch. You know, you stand your watch for however long it is, 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours. Okay? I was in Great Lakes, Illinois during a storm when we were going through school, and the snow was piling up, and it was horrendous outside. It was almost zero, and we still had to go, and we had to do our rounds. We had to go walk outside, but they cut our watches from 8 hours down to 4, and then they cut it from 4 down to 2. So everybody in the division got to go out and play in the snow. It says, now, behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison. And he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly." And his chains fell off his hands. Then the angel said to him, "Gird yourself and tie your sandals." And so he did. And the angel said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." So he went out and followed him, and did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they were past the first and the second guard posts, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them of its own accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. So here's Peter. He's out walking. He's got all of his clothes on, and he just, like it's nobody's business, walked out the front door. He's there with the two guards. They're still asleep, so they never woke up. His chains drop off. The angel tells him, "Hey, get yourself clothed up, man. Get your clothes on. Let's go. You know, make sure your boots are strapped up tight." You know, okay. And he's thinking he's in a dream. This is a dream world. This is not reality. So he goes out, and they go through the first gate. And the guards there don't even pay no mind to him. Just whatever. And they go to the gate that leads out into the city. And it opens all by itself. And as they go down, they walk down one street, and the angel leaves. He disappears. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jewish people." So, when he had considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. As Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a girl named Rhonda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter stood before the gate. 17, okay. So before the gate. But they said to her, "You are beside yourself." Yet she kept insisting that it was so. So they said, it is his angel." Now Peter continued knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. But motioning to them with his hand to keep silent, he declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, "Go, tell these things to James and to the brethren." And he departed and went to another place. Great things are achieved through prayer, especially through corporate prayer, meaning groups of people. For those of you here who haven't heard me say it before, you need to have an ecclesia. You need to have that small, tight group of people that accept each other for no matter what they are, what they have done, who they are, the color of their skin, the way they talk, you know, whatever. That you can speak of things that you do, and you can speak of things that have happened without any question of reprisal or condemnation. Because when the time comes, when you need prayer, you want to be able to bring it out. Maybe you are fighting with an addiction to something, or maybe you know, something has happened, you've done something, or somebody else has done something, and you need prayer about it. Or maybe you want to do something, and you need prayer about what it is you're looking at. Yes, God loves the children of the world. Absolutely, Cleo. And you need to have that, because when the time comes, if for whatever reason, one of us is put in chains, one of us is put into prison, just like what's going on in Washington right now. Steve Navarro, they want to go after Steve Bannon, okay? They don't have any case against him. They don't want anything, right? Exactly, Cleo. There are times when we have no idea, okay? A dear friend of mine died several years ago. He was a youth pastor. His whole life was for the kids. He'd actually gotten the building and he'd set up a skateboard park for the kids inside of this building. And then he had somebody donate a washer and a dryer and then a couple more, and so the homeless kids could come in there after school. They could wash their clothes and sometimes they could get a meal there and stuff. And it grew and it grew and it grew. Well, one night it was kind of raining and he was headed home, and a person going the wrong way on the road hit him. And people, the sworn affidavits say that there was more than one person in the vehicle. And I've read some of the affidavits, and I've had some of them told to me that they swear up and down that there was somebody in the vehicle leaning over him, okay, after the accident. And so they looked, there were no fingerprints, there was nothing inside that vehicle. And a very dear brother of mine, who was very tight with this other man, said that he knew, he didn't think, he didn't feel, he knew down in the inside of him that it was an angel. It was an angel of God that was there, that this person passed right there in the vehicle because of the accident, okay? So, we come in contact with angels a lot, okay? Some of them may look like homeless people. Some of them may look, you know, like bums. Some of them may look like somebody we don't even want to be around or hang out with. But see, that's the reason, folks, why when I pray to God, I ask Him to let me see through His eyes. Let me see it through His, because I don't want to see it through my eyes. I would much rather have my eyes taken out, because my heart judges because of what my heart or what my eyes see. But if I don't see it, then I don't have the chance to apply the prejudice or whatever it is to that person automatically, do I? If I don't see it, better yet, if I can see it through God's eyes, that this person is a child of God, then it's that much better, right? So, okay. Actually, it's okay. So it asks one question here. It asks two things, and it says, in each of the prior stories, there are two common denominators. Write down what you think they are. And I went through these and I poured over them and I started breaking it down. Okay. And the two things I came up with is in every single one of 5 verses that we've read, okay, or groups of verses. The first thing I came up with was all were taken to God in prayer. Every single one of these people, okay, had people praying for them. Okay, Peter. Or not Peter, but Paul. You know, he's in prison, right? And he has the church praying for him. Every single one of these is people praying. It's for somebody else. The mother that goes and does the unthinkable, a Canaanite going into an Israeli town and actually approaching a rabbi and crying out to him and calling him Lord. And his disciples are like, Lord, just send her away. Just send her away. She's going to cause a ruckus. It's going to be a problem. And he said, no. We got this. Okay. So he tests her. He says, why should I throw the bread of the children to the dogs? Basically, I'm paraphrasing. And she says, well, even the small dogs eat from the crumbs of the table of God. In other words, she's saying, I don't need a huge, huge blessing. Just give me, tell me what I should do. Give me an idea. Send me somewhere that I can get that which is needed for my daughter. And he says, because of your great faith, I'll go you one better. I will heal your daughter from right here. Okay. So, the other thing that I got out of this was, it was always prayer from others for another. Every single one of these in here. Okay. Abraham was speaking to God for the people of Israel. Well, Jacob was for himself. He asked him, you know, about who he was, okay? Moses denied himself food and water for 40 days. He was fasting. He was praying, okay, for the Israelites. The Canaanite woman was for her daughter. The church was praying for Peter. It was always for somebody else, folks. We need to do that. That's not to say we don't pray for our own family. We don't pray for ourselves. You do. But that's that alone, by yourself, in your personal space prayer time for you. When you're driving, if God puts somebody, if I'm driving along, like I got to go pick that freezer up today, and we're doing that, and if all of a sudden I get a notion about somebody, you know, whether it's been in here or somebody, a friend of mine or whatever, I'll take a minute, I'll stop and I'll pray for them, okay? I will take that time to stop and pray for them, and you do, Trip, you do, and that's one of the things I urge you to do. This is great, this Bible study is good. I mean, this is, you know, like a family, it's like church or whatever, but you need to have that group of people that you can throw your arms around and hug on them and cry together and laugh together, okay? You've got to have that. So, so now, the next one's going to be in Luke 18, 1 through 8. Luke 18, 1 through 8. And this is the parable of the woman and the judge. Then he spoke a parable to them. Now this is Jesus. That men always ought to pray and not lose heart. Okay. This saying, and this is Jesus, so I quote, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God, nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. In other words, vindicate me against them. Hear my case, make a judgment call, whatever you want, however you want to put it. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming, she weary me. In other words, she'll just keep coming and coming and coming and coming and coming, and he's just going to get really tired of it. So in other words, he's doing it for himself. Okay? Then the Lord said, quote, hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, meaning God, though he bears long with them? In other words, we keep crying out to God and keep crying out to God. And it's almost like crying to God saying, let me out of prison, let me out of prison, let me out of prison. And God's sitting there going, all you got to do is look on the table. The key to the lock on the door is on the table. Right? Sometimes, folks, we get so tied up into thinking that God's not hearing us, that we don't stop and look for the answer. We don't stop and look for what He has for us. Okay? Sometimes our prayers are already answered. We don't realize it yet. Okay? And shout, let's see, hang on a second. Luke, up to 8. Okay. Let's continue to hear me. Hear what the angel bears. Cry out day with him through, though he bears long with it. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. So God will avenge us speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on earth? This hit me so hard last night, folks. Verse 8, chapter 18, verse 8. I tell you that he, meaning God, will avenge them speedily. God will not tarry when he avenges us. He will not drag his heels. He'll not be like, well, maybe when I get done with that Bible study, you know, and then I got to wash the dishes and oh yeah, I got to mow the lawn, you know, and the truck needs gas, so I got to do that. But maybe when I get done with all that, no, that's not speedily. Speedily is, what? You need prayer? Yeah, let me stop everything right now. Let me pray for you. In fact, I got you on the phone. Let's pray right now together. Okay? Because always understand, where two or more are gathered, he is there also. Now that was back when they didn't have phones. They didn't have cell phones, right? But that still applies now. Where two of us are on the phone, if we're talking and we start praying together, he's there also. In fact, he's on both ends of that phone line. He's in both places at once. Okay? Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? Will he really find faith on the earth? What is faith? Faith, blind faith. Okay? Believing. And this is, if you guys watch the Santa Claus movies, you know this line from there. Seeing is not believing. Believing is seeing. People say, well, I don't see God. How do you tell me that there's a God and I can't see God? Seeing is not believing. Believing is seeing. I always answer them. That, do you see the wind? Well, yeah, look at the flag. No. I don't say look at the flag. I said, look up here. Look out here. Look around us. Do you see wind? Well, no, you can't see wind. But do you know it's there? Well, yeah. Well, how do you know it's there? Well, I feel it on my skin. I see the flag waving. I look down at the grass. The grass is waving back and forth. The tree's moving. No, you're not seeing wind. You're seeing effects of the wind, right? We don't get to see God until later on in our story. We get to see, we're blessed with seeing the effects of God every day. Understand, you get in your car and you drive somewhere and you get home. You think, oh, it's no big deal. I went down to this market and I got a gallon of milk and a loaf of bread and it cost me $280 and I came home. So what? That is the earthly view. That is people looking right now, right here. You don't know what happened through that whole thing. Maybe when you came up to that stoplight and you got mad because it turned real fast, it was like green and it's like, okay, I'm going to make it because I know it's going to go yellow and it'll be yellow for this long and then it'll be red and I'd be able to get through there. and it's like green, and it goes yellow, now red, just that fast. And you get all bent out of shape about it, and you're mad, and the light going the other direction turns green, and then a car goes driving through the intersection. You don't know if God just saved your life, because if he had left you on that yellow, you would have been going through that light. That car coming the other way may have been somebody who was distracted because of their cell phone, and they drove right into your car. Maybe you're dead. Maybe you're not. I don't know. Okay. There's I saw a meme out, and I told you guys about this a little while ago. It was about a guy, and he's got a business interview, and he's short on time. So he calls whatever it's like Hub Grub or, you know, whatever it is, you know, they deliver food. So he calls them and says, oh yeah, I need this and this and this. And okay. So they're bringing it. And so now he's running through the house, and he's trying to get dressed. And he's like 3/4 of the way dressed. He's got his sweaters on half. So he runs to the door, and they, you know, the money. And so he gives him the money, and he takes the food, right? And then he opens up the bag, and he pulls it out, and he goes, oh, cool, my burger. And he goes, before he could bite it, right, it drops on the ground. And he's like, oh, I don't have time to do that. I'm going to leave that for right now, right? I'm from Asian. Nice to meet you. How you doing, MLBB? And so then he runs outside because he's going to get in his car. He jumps in his car, and he's like trying to start it, and nothing's happening. So he calls for an Uber, and the guy comes out, and he opens the door, and he says, I need to go to this place. And the guy goes, I'm not going over there. That's a long drive. I'm not going clear over there. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to take you. So he shuts the door, and he starts walking back up into his yard, and he's getting upset. And he finally goes, God, why did you let all this happen? Why did you do this? Why this? And, you know, all of a sudden, you know, you have the other guy, boom, there he is. It's the same person. You know, he's just dressed different. It makes him look like God or whatever. And he says, well, let me show you. He says, you remember that sandwich? And he says, yeah. And then he shows him kind of, you see this picture of the guy that was delivering the food. He opened up the bag and he spit on the food. And the guy was like, ooh. He goes, yeah, that's why you didn't get that hamburger. And he said, but what about my car? Why wouldn't my car start? And he goes, oh yeah, your car. Well, maybe this is why. And it shows it, and all of a sudden the car explodes. And he's like, wow. He says, yeah. He goes, why couldn't I take the Uber? Why couldn't I take the Uber to go get this? This job's mean a lot. I can go get the Uber, right? And then he shows the Uber driver gotten in an accident. Didn't even make it anywhere near where he was going to go. We don't understand, folks, when things go sideways on us, when things get upside down, okay? It's not our place a lot of times to know. That's why it's really, really hard sometimes when people ask you questions, when people ask me, why does this, I don't know. I truly don't. Okay, I have hard time figuring out what's going on in my life. Why did this happen? Why did that happen? Why can't I do this? Why can't I do that? Okay. And I do ask those questions once in a while. And then it comes to me that it's not my place to know. My place is to do that which God wants me to do. In time, it will make sense. Exactly. Exactly, Tripp. It's not our place to question God. Okay. And I have to leave it at that. I have to be, and it's taken me a long, long time to get to that point, to accept that fact that, you know what? I don't need to know. If God feels that it's time for me to know, or if God wants me to know, okay, then he'll make it happen. Okay, and I could point you at several instances in my life that, which I'm not going to get into, but where things have happened, and it's like, why? Why? I thought this is where you wanted me. I thought this is what I'm supposed to be doing. you brought me to this point, but why is this happening to me? And sometimes I don't find out at all. Other times, one specifically that I can think of, it was 12 years later before I found out why. Okay? And when I found out why, I realized that God saved three people that night. He saved three people's lives that night by me not knowing. So, prayer is how we talk to God. Prayer is where we have that personal relationship with God. That's what God wants. He wants that relationship with us. Okay? Some people look at it and they say, oh, well, you just want to bow your knee down. You just want to bow down to them, to this God that you think and everything. And that's all he wants. He wants you to be his slave. No. No. I have no chains on me. I have no strings on me. I'm not a puppet. I'm not a slave. I have free choice. Okay? I could choose right now to take every single piece of equipment I have in my garage and put it out on the street and say free. Okay? I have freedom of choice that I could, take my car and go and rent it off of one of the cliffs around here. I have the opportunity for that free choice. The thing is that God also gives me understanding and wisdom. And in that, I understand my place. Okay? I am a son. I am a child of God. Understand that. Child. As we look at children, they are growing. They're smart. Okay? They understand. And yet at the same time, they need more. They need aunts. They need uncles. They need grandparents. They need grandfathers and mothers. They need people, influences in their life, to help them understand what right is, what good is. Because if they don't, then they could end up in a bad situation. If they're taught what good is, what right is, then they'll know when something is wrong. As they grow older, as they experience more things, they understand that was wrong. This is what was right. I did this, that another person did that. Okay, I didn't get in trouble. They did. So, the last one, they said to write it out, or actually the last two. So the first one would be Luke 18, 1 through 8, which I already read. So then the last one is 1 John 5, 14 and 15. It says, tell why you think God allows himself to be convinced. So 14 reads, now this is the confidence that we have in him, meaning God, and if we ask anything according to his, meaning God, will, he hears us. And if we know that he, God, hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. In other words, if we ask something of God and he hears us, then we have that which we asked for. And in doing that, we understand, because hypothetical situation, you have a child. Okay, and a child says, mommy, can I have dog food for dinner? Usually the answer is going to be something along the lines of, no, honey, we don't eat dog food. That's for dogs. Okay. Maybe you live on a ranch and you've got straw or wheat out there, and you say, mommy, can I go out, or alfalfa, mommy, can I go out and eat alfalfa out with the horses? No, honey, we don't eat that. The child understands the concept of eating. the child understands that they want to try new things. As a parent, we're to help them understand that some things we don't eat. Animals eat that. I don't. You don't. We don't. And that when we pray for something, God already knows what it is. He is waiting for us to ask. He's waiting for us to come to Him and ask and say, look, Lord, why did this happen? What happened? What do I do in this situation? I don't know where to go. I don't know who to turn to. Okay? For years and years, I used to watch a TV show that's called NCIS. And the guy, the lead actor in the thing, his name was Gibbs. And he had a set of rules. One of his rules was, is there are no coincidences. And I believed that for a long, long time. And then I realized that he was right. There are no coincidences. Because when things happen, there's only two powers that allow that those things to happen. Either it happens from God and it's a blessing, or it happens because of an action that we took and it comes from the evil. There's no in between. Okay? Sometimes things happen because somebody else is acting on input from the evil side or from God. Okay? Maybe you're hanging out with some buddies and they're going to start drinking. Okay? And you're like, man, I ain't drinking. No, I'm done. I haven't had any. I'm not going to drink. I'm going to go ahead and head home for the night. Right? So they start giving you a bad time. Well, now they're trying to change your mind, aren't they? They're trying to change your decision. So you go outside and you're going to try and call somebody to come pick you up because you rode over with them. And you're standing out there, you know, and it starts to rain. Oh, man. Oh, great. You know, so you look around. Oh, there's a canopy over here. So you go get underneath the canopy. And you're standing there trying to call. You know, you can't. Your phone's dead. You're trying to figure out what you're going to do, you know. And somebody comes walking by and they're like, oh, hey, you need a ride? You know, I can give you a ride wherever you're going. And you're like, well, yeah, okay. Yeah, I guess. You know, you don't know who this guy is. And, you know, as you start to turn, all of a sudden you hear a horn honk. And the guy that was inside with you saw what you did about, no, I'm not going to drink, you know, I'm not going there. Well, he was the driver. So he comes pulling up in his car and he rolls down the window. And he says, hey, Trip, you need a ride? Look, man, I heard what you said and you're absolutely right. I got exams tomorrow or whatever. I got to get home. I got to get some sleep. Those knuckleheads are going to be there all night long. They're going to be there all night long drinking. They ain't got no reason to go to bed early. Let me give you a ride home. Because of an action that you made, you stood up and said, no, I'm not going to be drinking. I'm going home. Okay. It created a chain of events where that other person heard what you said. It influenced them to a point where they decided, you know what? Trip was right. I'm not going to drink. I'm going home. I'll see you guys later, you know? And so he goes and gets in his car and comes around and he picks Trip up, takes Trip home. Now everybody's home safe. Decisions are based off of input. A lot of times input comes from different points, folks. We have to look for God, look to Him for what His input is, okay? Hey, Josie, talking about God, talking about prayer. So the last thing I got out of this is because the question was, tell why you think God allows Himself to be convinced. I said, He doesn't allow Himself to be convinced. He already wanted, He already wanted to bless us. He wants to make sure we understand our need for Him. He wants us to understand that our need for Him. Okay? How many of you have kids? And I remember when I was a little kid, you know, this was a big thing back then. Now, probably not so much because everybody's got all electronics, so they don't want to leave mommy and daddy's house. But I remember being a kid and going out and say, well, you know what? You guys are being mean to me. I don't like you anymore. I'm going to leave. I'm going to run away from home. You pack up a little sack or whatever, and you take some clothes and a couple of toys with you, and you walk out the door. Well, you're all, you know, humped up, and you're just, oh, look at me. I'm somebody, you know. You get down to the corner, and you're like, well, I wonder which way I should go. I'll go this way, I guess. And you start walking up the street. And you get a block up the street, and pretty soon it's like, wow, that's kind of far, but I haven't been. I don't want to go that way because that looks scary. I haven't been. I'll go this way. And you walk up the next street, and pretty soon you hear a car coming up behind you, you know, and you're just kind of walking along, and it's like, man, I really don't want to go home. You know, I feel like a fool, this and that, and blah blah blah. And then the car pulls up next to you, and it's your dad, and he says, hey. I thought I'd let you know, Mom decided to have spaghetti for dinner tonight. I know you really like spaghetti, so, you know, maybe you just want to have a meal for the road. So I figured I'd come and ask you. You know, you don't have to come. You can keep going. That's up to you. You know, you're being your own person. So, but if you want to, you know, I can give you a ride back to the house, and then after dinner, you know, and everything, and then I'll bring you back up here. I'll drop you off here, and you can go ahead and go about whatever you're doing, right? And by the time dinner's over, we all know what happens. You know, everybody's joking and laughing and everything's fine. And the little kid forgets about what he was all upset about. All the parents want is for the child to understand that they love them and want them. That's what God wants for each one of us. We have to understand that when things happen, they don't always happen because of God. Things happen in spite of God. He will protect us. He will make sure that we don't end up dead, okay? I have another good friend that's one of his sayings. Rule number one is don't get dead. And they don't want that for us, but sometimes accidents happen. I've been out four-wheeling with people who, some of them are running like really loose between the ears. I'm out there. I'm crazy. These guys make me look like I am just stone sober, sane. And we've been out and ended up rolling one of the guys' trucks down a hill. Okay. Wasn't a good thing, wasn't a good idea. You know, we both walked away from it. The truck didn't. I've been in accidents, you know, and stuff. And just, it's, if it was 2 minutes earlier, 2 minutes later, it would have been a bigger vehicle, or it would have been a steeper hill, or it would have been whatever. We just have to remember that God is the one that we got to keep going back to. Exactly, Naomi. I'm right there with you. It's you know, I am here because of 15 foot of wall that was built. Okay. Because in Kern County up here there's a mountain road and they extended a wall by 13 feet. 15 feet, something like that. It's 150 feet from that wall, from the ground. If you stand up where that wall is, it's 150 feet straight down this hill. Actually, mountain. And when we went back up there, my navigator and I went up and looked at it and realized that there were still two cars sitting down there in the bottom. Yeah, things happen. But we have to look to God and don't expect an answer. Don't say, hey, God, I need this. And he goes, oh, okay, here, let me give it to you. No, be careful what you ask for. God, I need patience. Life's going to get hard. Life's going to get really tough because you're going to have to learn patience. Oh, God, I want strength. I want strength. You're going to have to learn to be strong in your faith. So, I appreciate you guys being here. It is vitally important that you get into your word. It is vitally important that you read your Bible, okay? Yep. I have a friend, not that bad, but they climbed onto the running boards. They ran and jumped up onto the running boards of their brother's truck, and they slipped because he just got done washing it. And when they slipped, they fell underneath, and the back tires went right over their legs. He still walks with braces. And yeah, they're not planned, folks. They're accidents. But sometimes there are reasons why. Okay? So, we each need to look. We each need to pray about these things. I urge you to get into a prayer group where you are, people that you can touch, people that you can hug on, people that you can cry with and like that, okay? On the phone, yeah, that's good too, but you still need to have people around you because there's something about that warm hug when the world's falling apart, okay? When you lose a parent or you lose a child, okay, for whatever reason, just the warmth of that hug, somebody to hold on to, while you just turn on the waterworks and let it rip. You need somebody like that, okay? So, I appreciate y'all being here. I'll be back again tomorrow morning. As you know, we take Sundays off, but we'll be doing this again tomorrow. We got one more study this week. This is week 19. So after this, we only got 4 more weeks, got 1 more month, and we're done with this study. And I'm looking at a couple of different ones, and we'll see where it goes from there. So, again, I appreciate y'all being here. If you would do me the honor of, on your way out, make sure you hit the like button. If you feel so inclined to subscribe, there's no charge to subscribe. It's you know, just for their algorithmic numbers. We'll go from there. All right. I hope you guys have a blessed day. Let me get you prayed up for the day, okay? Father God, I just thank you for your word. Lord God, I just thank you for your grace and for your love, for all that you do for us each and every day. I thank you, Father God, for saving me from so many stupid, catastrophic incidences, things that could have happened but didn't. I thank you, Father God, that you would bless me so richly with a family here, with all these people, different countries, Father God, different nations, different states, and yet we're all still the same. We all are still alike each other. We all know who you are, Father. We all know that you are the creator of everything. And in that, Father God, you created us to be who we are. You have given us a mission. So I pray, Father God, that each person here, as they are so led, that their mission would become prevalent in their life. Whatever their walk in life is, whatever they do as job or work or school, that at the same time, Father, that you would bless them as they grow in their knowledge and wisdom of you to prepare them for whenever it is that you are going to put them in place of the job, the direction, whatever it is that they need to go. I thank you, Lord God, for this time. I thank you for the opportunity to have this show, Father God. And I just thank you, Father God, that we have this time together. I ask your blessings upon each and every person and their families, Father God, their friends. Where there is strife, where there is need, where there is hurt, where there is anger, Father God, please let someone walk in and let someone help to diffuse that, to take it away, that people could find peace and joy in you, Father God. Again, I thank you for your word, Lord. I thank you for this time and your teaching. In Jesus' precious and holy name I pray. Amen. All right, folks. Thank you guys for being here. Tammy, thank you for being here. I just happened to see your name. Naomi, thank you so very much for all that you do. Guys, we need to thank her. We need to give her a thanks for what she does when she's here. She's taken time out of her day to be here with us to moderate. And she also helps me on the back end of getting stuff set up and such. So, Check your news, folks. I just got a thing that says Trump wins the trial in New York. So I don't know what's going to happen there, but we'll figure that one out. Anyways, I appreciate y'all being here. It means a lot to me, but it's more, hopefully it's for you, for all that you guys need, okay? So, for all of my brothers and sisters, the veterans and active duty, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, National Guard, Coast Guard, which one did I miss? Oh, Space Force. I got all the flags down here on my bench, so I sometimes forget. To all the police, sheriffs, constables, law enforcement, air rescue, life flight, search and rescue teams, please, just one more day. Don't make a decision. Do not choose the easy way out. Okay. Folks, today was red. It is Red Friday. Remember everybody deployed. Remember everybody detained. Don't make a decision that you're going to regret. Okay. You need to be here for somebody. I promise you that. There is somebody that needs you here. So act accordingly. Be here for whoever that person is. Because if you don't see tomorrow's sunrise, I promise you, you will be dearly and sorely missed. You will be breaking somebody's heart. So don't make that choice out of selfishness. Make the choice to stay out of grace. Okay? Don't ever stop. You need to keep moving. KFG. I love you guys very much. And I will talk to you tomorrow morning. We'll be here again at 7 a.m. Pacific time. If you go by Greenwich Mean Time, I am at Greenwich Mean Time -8, and that will equal 7. So right now in Greenwich, it's 1700 hours. It's 5 p.m. there. So I think maybe it's the other direction. No, it's ahead. Yeah, it'd be 5 p.m. Anyways, hello, Elena and John. Welcome. I'm sorry, we're closing up. We just finished with the Bible study. We started at 7 o'clock, and so we'll be back here tomorrow morning, though. Okay. So, you guys take care. I love you very, very much. And to my brothers and sisters, KFG. I love you guys, and I will talk to you tomorrow. Bye-bye.